Okay, it's great to start with that music to make us more patient. Okay, this may be the last lecture we do it online. So as I sent an email about 2 days ago, we can invite people to come to us for sure, respecting the number that it must not exceed 30. So we may have the lecture part online and part on site. Hopefully we will resume our activities on site, and we may also run several workshops before the end of the year here at the academy. So welcome to all. Thank you for being on time for this bi-monthly lecture. So has become a tradition that every 2 weeks, one of us is going to present something to talk about. And this time, so we have Miss Asma. She is part of the Radio Astronomy laboratory, and she is responsible for the 40 meter radio interferometer. And today she is going to talk about it and when will it work 100%. Hopefully we'll have some good news and how the observation are doing. So Asma, are you ready, inshallah?
Yes, inshallah.
Okay, so you have the stage, so you can start.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. My name is Asma Al-Hamid, and I'm a research assistant at the Sharjah Academy for Astronomy and Space Sciences. So I'm a part of what's called Sharjah 40-meter radio interferometer. And today's talk is going to be somewhat interesting to you if you are not familiar with this system. So, what is an interferometer and what can it do? If you are hearing the word interferometer for the first time, you probably have similar questions in your head right now. But we are going to explain briefly and in a general way so that non-experts could understand. So this talk will have a brief history on radio astronomy. It will have an introduction on EM spectrum, radio frequency band in specific. And then we will go to types of radio antenna, reflective radio dishes. Later on, we will have a look at what kind of radio sources that we can observe, advantages and disadvantages of radio astronomy, and then basics, general basics of radio interferometry and some definitions and principles. And of course, at the end, we will introduce you to the Sharjah 40-meter radio interferometer. So let's go back in time where it all has started. If you are not familiar with this guy, this man is named Carl G. Jansky, and he is an American physicist and a radio engineer that used to work in Bell Laboratories, New Jersey. This man, or this engineer, was assigned to investigate the sources of static that might interfere with the radio transmission. So what he did was the following. He designed an antenna that works at 20.5 megahertz, and it looked like that back then. And it has a tires, so it could rotate in all directions. So it was given the name Jansky's merry-go-round. This is a recent replica of the system that is at the Green Bank Observatory. So what he did, basically, he recorded all the signals that he could detect with this telescope or antenna, and he categorized them into nearby thunderstorms, distant thunderstorms, and faint, steady hiss of unknown origin. Now he spent years investigating the source of the third type of static. He noticed peaks recurring every 20 minutes. This is one of Carl Jansky's records. And if you see, there's a peak, and then you get a peak again, and then a peak, and so on. Now these peaks were an indication of radio waves originating from beyond Earth. And if you notice at the graph, they start from south, and with time, in 2 hours' time, they appear to be heading towards southwest. Now, Jansky found that the interference seemed to come at irregular intervals of 23 hours, 56 minutes, and 4 seconds. And with more investigation, he concluded that this radiation is coming from the Milky Way and was strongest in the direction of the center of the galaxy, specifically in the constellation of Sagittarius. Now, he was no astronomer, so he had to compare his observations with optical astronomical maps. So he found that the radiation was coming from the Milky Way. Later on, he published his findings in a paper titled Electrical Disturbances Apparently of Extraterrestrial Origin. And in his writing, he referred to this type of noise as star noise. Now, several scientists followed in his footsteps. They were interested in Dansky's discovery. One of them was Groot Reber. He was a radio engineer, and he built his own telescope in his backyard. It was an advanced one, advanced than Dansky's, and of a parabolic type, 9 meters in diameter. Now, he worked on completing a radio frequency map that he completed in about 1941 to 1943. It was extended in 1943. And he also published his work as contour maps. It was thanks to this guy that the existence of some radio sources such as Cygnus A and Cassiopeia A came out for the first time. So another scientist was also interested in this work. It was John Cross. He was an American physicist, and he designed Big Ear Radio Telescope at Ohio State University. It was used to carry out the Ohio Sky Survey, which was basically an astronomical survey of extragalactic radio sources. And what's special about this telescope was that it detected a very unique signal that is later on was known as the WOW signal. The signal was received on August 15, 1977. Now, the WOW signal appeared to come from the direction of the constellation of Sagittarius too, and was labeled as an extraterrestrial signal of origin. Now, this signal lasted about 72 seconds. Now, if you look at the scale here, you have time on the x-axis, and you have from 0 to 9, and then the scale goes from A to like A, B, C, D, and so on. So this is the code that was recorded, and if you follow in the X and Y coordinates, this is the shape of the wave that they detected. Now this signal remained a strong candidate for an alien radio transmission. It was never detected later on. Now enough about history, it's all in the past. And let's go to what is an electromagnetic spectrum, a modern electromagnetic spectrum. Now we see here, let's start from the visible light. It is within this range. And if you go high in frequency, you get ultraviolet, X-rays, and gamma rays, high frequency, short wavelength, and high energy. And if you go to the left, you have the infrared, microwaves, radio waves, and so on. Low frequency, low energy, and long wavelength. Now let's take the radio waves more specifically and zoom in into that band. We found that it has even more small bands. It depends on the application that is used in. So we have very low frequency, we have low frequency, high frequency, and so on until we get to extremely high frequency. And each band has its own applications like navigation, radio navigation, AM and FM, TV, and satellite communication, and so on. Now, if you want to do observations in any of these bands, you need to have a suitable antenna and suitable for each of the applications. So what types of antenna can we use, or do we know? This is a list of the antennas that you might be familiar with, some of them. You have, for example, the dipole or the Yagi that used to be that are used in TVs, CRT TVs. You have the horn antenna. It is used for range radar systems. This is a dipole. This is the Yagi. This is the horn, and the infamous parabolic antenna. It also has types like the Cassegrain, where the feed is in a different position. Now, I have an antenna and I want to do an observation of some source. What kind of sources that I can observe? Sources, let's classify them into three categories, where we have within the solar system, we have the sun. The sun is known to be the closest star to us, and it emits in all kind of almost all frequencies. And the effect is more noticeable if there are solar storms. Also in the solar system, we have planet Jupiter, that emits radio waves due to the interactions between the planet's magnetic wave, magnetic field, and the volcanic moon Io that rotates around the planet. Now let's expand and go far away from the solar system. We have radio sources that are within the Milky Way. Let's start with the center of the galaxy, Sagittarius A. It's basically a black hole and is surrounded by an enormous number of stars. A second source of radio emission is supernova remnants. They are basically when the star reaches its end, it consumes basically all its fuel of hydrogen, and then at the end it explodes, and whatever material of star that remains scatter in space and form a huge cloud, just like you see here in the picture. Another source is a neutron star and also pulsars. Now, neutron stars, as we just said about these, the supernova remnants, they are a result of giant supernova remnants that collapse. So if you have a high density, a great density and a low size, neutron stars have high density and smaller in size, and they also have a magnetic field. And their temperature is relatively very, very high. And the pulsars are just rotating neutron stars. A last source of radio emission could be the star formation regions, which is basically regions of dust and gas where stars form, and it contains abundant amount of elements such as hydrogen and helium. So now after, if you go and leave the Milky Way, we have sources from outside of the Milky Way. For example, we have radio galaxies such as Cygnus A, one of the strongest radio sources in the sky. And just like we mentioned before, that it was discovered thanks to Groot Reber. And then this was named as the first radio galaxy. Also, we have the background microwave radiation, which is basically the leftover of the Big Bang theory. Now, why should I go for radio astronomy? Now let's go over some of the advantages and disadvantages of radio astronomy. Now, the biggest advantage is that radio telescopes can operate day and night and nearly in any type of weather, except let's say very snowy weather or strong thunderstorms, sometimes high wind speed. Another advantage over the optical observation is that you can observe even if the day is cloudy. Also, radio waves are immune to dust. Okay, so one of the disadvantages of radio waves, as you can see here, is the energy of a photon is very low. So you need to build arrays in order to collect more radio waves. Another factor that can affect the observation is the telescope power. And also its size affects the observations. For example, at far distances, the image might look like that. So you need a powerful telescope so that you can see details into the source that you're observing. And one last thing, you need to be at a radio frequency free zone, so that you do not pick up any of the man-made interferences. Sometimes people observe in so-called protective bands, which are bands that are dedicated for radio astronomy, and you do not find interference in these. Now let's go to the main powers of a telescope. We have the light gathering power. So, let's stick with this. The bigger, the better when it comes to the size of the antenna or the telescope, because the bigger it is, it will collect more energy. And since the gathering or light gathering power depends on the diameter of the dish, then the area of the dish is indicated. So for example, if you have a 1 meter telescope, it will give you an area of one, regardless of what is the unit. So you can see an object that is one at 1 AU, astronomical unit. Then if you have a 2 meter telescope, you get a bigger area than the first one, and you can observe the same object if it was at 2 AU, the same object that was observed in one. The same goes for an even larger larger sizes. So with a 3 meter, you get an area of nine units, and you can observe the same source again at an even further distance. So when it comes to resolving power, let's take an example. Think of this image as the following. For example, this is a car that is coming towards you. It is at night, and these represent the front lights. So when the car is far away, you cannot tell if this is one car, two cars, or how many cars are there. You see that the two lights, the two front lights of the car are overlapping. So as the car starts approaching you, you start to see that there are two lights clearly. So basically, resolving power is the minimum angular distance between two objects that can be separated. Like the moment you can tell that, okay, I have two objects here and not one, that's the minimum angular resolution that you need. These are just barely resolved two sources, and this is fully resolved. Like you can tell this is a source and that is a source. But in the first case, it is not really clear how many sources are there. Well, in space, we have such examples as binary stars or individual stars of galaxies that have a smaller separation angle. Okay. Now, this is somehow of a problem for radio astronomers or radio astronomy in general. So what we need is an interferometer to solve the problem. Okay, so do you remember the two slit experiment? Okay, so we have a source, and then it shines on two slits, and then you get two more sources of the same light again. Now you have a screen or a film of some sort, and in between you get the interference between the two waves that are coming from the two sources. Now the sources, the two sources or secondary sources, they are of the same wavelength. So what you get is an interference, either destructive interference or constructive interference. Okay, as we just mentioned. Okay, so as we mentioned, the pattern on the screen depends on the distance that is traveled from the two slits to the screen. Now, how is that related to interferometry? Let's take an antenna or a telescope. This is an antenna, and this is my radio source that I want to observe. So if I use a telescope, I can observe it, and maybe I get something, or I don't get anything, or a blurry image or something like that. It depends on the resolution of my telescope, the size of the telescope, and so on. Now let's add one more telescope. Okay, so this is a one telescope system. Now let's add another one more telescope that is separated by a distance D, call it D, and they both point at the same source in the sky. They both will measure the electrical signal, and they will measure the electrical signals and then received from the radio source that you're observing. Now you see that the telescope to the right is somewhat closer to the telescope to the left. When it comes to the signal here, you get the signal first, and then this one for the second telescope, it needs more time to reach the other telescope. So the wave front, this is the wave front, it will reach one telescope before the other. What we need to do is we need to delay the signal by the extra time that is needed to take to reach the other telescope. Yeah. This is a signal delay for the first one because it receives the signal first. And so that you get an in-phase signal, you need to figure out how much signal delay you need. And of course, the signal delay happens before you combine both signals. Okay. Now, basically, radio interferometry is a technique where you combine radio sources from two or more radio telescopes. And the angular resolution becomes the lambda over the new baseline of the system. Now, if the telescope or the two dishes are close to each other, they will record almost exactly the same thing, the same combination. There is not much space in between. So you get such a similar pattern. This can tell you that you might have a one source, a point source, okay? Now, if I were to move the dishes far apart, you will see like these two telescopes will give you a different complicated interference pattern. Sometimes you can, with the second method, like if you increase the separation between the telescopes, maybe you can figure out that, no, I don't have a point source or a one source. Now I have more than source at that part of the sky that we're observing. Now, the base, to summarize, like interferometry is to combine more than one telescope to get more resolution or better reception. Now, do we have any radio interferometers around the world? Yes, we do. We have some examples here. The VLA, which has 27 antennas, each is 25 meters in diameter, and you have the very long VLBA, which consists of 10 antennas. It's like a network. Each antenna is 25 meters and within approximately 8,000 kilometer baseline. Also, we have WSRT. It consists of 14 antennas. Also, they are 25 meters in diameter. Also, we have the Merlin or eMerlin. It is 7 antennas. We have ATCA, Atacama Telescope. Something. It's a 6 antenna, 22 meters in diameter, and then we have ALMA. These are some of the examples of radio interferometers around the world. Now we come to a new addition to these interferometers, which is the Charger 40 meter radio interferometer. This is the first ever system in the MENA region, and it works at 1.4 gigahertz. It is a set of three 5 meter radio telescope of a Spider 500A type. It is Italian made by the company Prima Luce Lab. Now these three telescopes form a scalene triangle of size 30, 40 and 50 meter. And the system has an angular resolution of 0.3 degrees and a collecting area that of an antenna 8.7 meters in diameter. Now the system started with extending wires underground and then putting a pier for each of the telescope, three telescopes. On top of the pier comes the electronic out-as mount, and we have the feed horn. Later on, the dish was assembled on ground and then lifted by a crane and attached to the top of the mount. Now this is a full image of the telescope. You see telescope one and telescope two in the picture. Now this is a final image of how the system looks like. It also has a security system that remotely monitors the telescopes during observations in the night, and also a weather station to record the wind speed and rain levels. There is an underground You can see it here, an underground control room that has all the receivers and the PCs, and each one is controlling one of the telescopes. Now the control room, it was supposed to be in the middle, which is, and this is the initial design of the three telescopes, that's the initial stages. The control room is two meters underground, the part of it that is underground, and it hosts all the receivers, just like you saw. Now, okay, let's go and see a glimpse of the telescope in real life. I think I need to share the other screen. Okay. So this is how the telescope, the final three telescopes in the academy. This is the control unit, and you see here the three cameras, each looking at one of the telescopes, and then there is the weather station here. Now going far away to come closer from the other side, let's fast forward to one of the telescopes. So you see this is up here, and this is the electronic mount. It is completely computerized and controlled from the software. This is a feed horn. And so on. Okay. So now we go back to the presentation. What can we do at 1.4 gigahertz? We can observe even more sources than I've just listed. We can study the sun in both situations. We can study the reflected waves of the moon. We can study some other nebulas and galaxies and so on. Now, this is a radio map of the sun that was created using one of the three telescopes. Only one was working at that time, and it is 63 by 63 pixels. And the telescope, one telescope resolution is 3 degrees. So to get that interferometer, we of course had to do a simulation first. We used the NRAO simulation application, and the source that was observed in the simulation was Cygnus A. The duration was for 60 minutes, and this is the final configuration of the SAST triangle configuration for the radio telescope. Now what we are planning to do with this system is to study the structure of the Milky Way, to map the rotation curve to determine the velocity of the hydrogen clouds in the spiral arms, to observe hundreds of extra extended radio galaxies, and perform extensive radio surveys also, to calculate masses of galaxies and study dynamics of individual galaxies. We also want to search for probable potential extraterrestrial intelligence and perform extensive radio surveys of all different objects of our solar system. Like, for example, some current studies are going on for the sun and for the reflected waves of the moon. And at the end, we would like to have to establish an educational observatory for teaching radio astronomy and research tool for new radio astronomers. Now at the end, to conclude, we are at the final stages of the system, the interferometer. We are in the last stage where we have to develop the, to contact the Italians for development of the multimillion channel backend. That's also named as the correlator. And also we need to upgrade the RF cables to fiber optics. And in the future, we propose to add six more antennas to make an array with a baseline of 400 kilometers across the UAE. Now, this is a nice broadcast of Carl J. Jansky, and I recommend that you listen to it. It is by Christopher Crockett. I'll leave it here for a minute so that you can scan the code. Okay, that was all. So if you have any questions, you can contact us or contact the supervisor of the system or the project, Dr. Yes, for me. Thank you very much.
السلام عليكم. ألو. السلام عليكم. فينا نسأل أسئلة الآن ولا لا؟ We can ask some. I have a question.
Yes, you can. I'll write in
yes,
the chat.
Please, just can you return back to the slide where we can see the free zone when we talk? You was talking about the free zone. Radio sources.
Okay.
Just, I would like to see this.
Just a minute. Can I just share the screen one more time?
I think the third or fourth one.
One?
Yes. Here, how we know that there is no interference with, you know, we are surrounded by a lot of radio source here from the phones. There is a lot of antenna around us. How
yes.
we can, is there any filter in the radio telescope that mean can prevent us, the radio source, interferometry radio source? From
okay.
around?
Yes, okay, good question. Some of the interferometers that I just showed you, if you notice, they are either in the desert or far, far away from the population. So either you go for this choice, just build your system somewhere far away, or there are some selected radio frequencies that you do not have man-made transmission in them. They are called astronomy or radio astronomy protective bands. If you can Google them, you can get them in bands like from this frequency to that frequency. Like I don't memorize them, but there is a list on the internet that you can search for. And this way you can like prepare your observation based on the frequency that you want. Also, let's say that some of the systems might have some filters for like, let's say some bands, small bands, okay? For example, let's say that I have a TV station that is affecting my transmission. In the interferometer that I just showed you, there is a property that lets you to eliminate this filter. Okay, so
okay.
it's either from the system or you can just manage it some other way.
Okay, that means there is a filters for that.
Yeah, yes, in the system that I've worked with, there are filters that I can exclude these interferences.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Asma, for this good presentation.
Can I also ask Asma? Yeah, this is Dr. Daniel. Thank you for your presentation. I was quite interested to see regarding, I mean, what is the interferometer? Because in geology, because I'm a geologist, they use the interferometer to detect ground motion. I mean, the movements that the crust of our planet is doing by using interferometer. Do you have any clue how they do that? I mean, how you They combine these observations of the radio signal or waves that you are receiving and translate it to motion of the ground. Have you heard or have you seen this use of interferometer, or is totally different thing, what I'm mentioning here.
Okay, one thing I know is that for the seismic movement or motion of the crust is, they use low frequencies for that.
Okay.
Yeah, but I actually didn't, you know, it didn't, I didn't read about that, so I have no idea on this.
Because I was just asking that maybe, also others might know something, because I don't know, that's why I'm asking, but I have used that. I'm actually writing now a paper where a colleague from France has used interferometer in Oman, I mean in the neighboring country here, where the 3 years data of interferometer is giving us up to 5 millimeters of motion, and they say that is very, very precise. So I was wondering that if the antennas that you have already installed here, they can be used in the future just to show ground motion, at least in the area of Sharjah, because that would be very interesting if we are somehow, there is a way to collect data throughout the years, because that needs years of data collection, I think, and so some movement. So. That's another use that I have heard that it can be used. And actually, as I said, we are using that now in a publication. We are giving maps where the ground motion has been acquired by the use of interferometer. Okay, that was my point. Thank you. Anyway, that's very interesting what you're doing.
I can jump in here because what Daniel is mentioning is a completely different thing. You're mentioning about SAR, which is a synthetic aperture interferometry, which is actually you send a signal and then you have instruments that you can track this signal, and you can use a similar technique. I mean, the interferometric technique is always similar. And you can reconstruct the Earth. And if you have a time series of data over a long period of time, you can monitor motion of the Earth. I don't know. I know that it is pretty precise. I don't know if you can go as low as a few millimeters or centimeters or how low you can go. But this is a completely different technique. This one is a completely different technique between synthetic aperture radio interferometer, like SAR that you mentioned, and what interferometry is used in astronomy. First of all, you cannot turn the antennas to the ground. Technically, you cannot do that. In astronomy, you have the antennas pointing to the sky, so you cannot study the Earth on that. And second of all, it depends also on the wavelength that you are using.
Thank you, Antonis. I was thinking that, the antennas are mounted stable in the ground, so the signal which are taking, If the antennas are moving millimeters up or down per year, then the antennas can identify the.
These antennas, in general, the antennas, they have also problems. I mean, they you have structural issues because they are big things. They need maintenance. So a few millimeter can occur there. Okay. But the thing is that first of all, the SAR technique, the synthetic aperture, is something completely different. You have to be on a satellite or on a drone or somewhere, and you have to create a source of radio wave. You send it to the ground, it bounces back to the ground, and then you reconstruct an image on that. And you are using interferometry, the same technique, but not really exactly the same technique. Interferometry is something every time that you have two waves, that these two waves are combined, you have an interferometry. But not in this case. In astronomy, you cannot do that. First of all, because the antennas are not pointing to the ground. Second of all, the wavelength is different. I don't know what is the wavelength of SAR.
Yeah, I don't remember. Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know what is the wavelength of SAR and how you can do that. But indeed, you can measure pretty accurately landslides and processes that you have in geology. But the technique is different. The technique is very, very different. And also the wavelength might be completely different. Here, you are speaking for wavelength of a few gigahertz. I think this one will be slightly different.
So you need the antennas on the satellites. You need the antennas on the other side, let's say, not on the on Earth. Yeah. So I got
the antennas on a satellite, yes, or on a drone or somewhere else.
Yeah. Yeah. Probably they're using the radiation that I don't know, but the radiation that is reflected back from the crust from the surface of the planet. So maybe they're using the natural radiation or something. I don't know. I'm not sure. But you said they should have a source of radiation also.
Any more questions?
Thank you, Asma.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Asma. Shukran. Thank you,
Asma. It was great.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here, and hope to see you in the future lectures.